I'm Stefan Baumann, and welcome once again to the Baumann Effect, number 13. Now, 13 is considered to be an unlucky number, but today it is your lucky number for tuning in. We're going to be talking about composition and focal points and eye magnets and how to compose. And the information that we are doing today will be good for landscape painting and still life painting and portraiture. There's so much content in this one video that from now on, 13 is going to be your lucky number. So sit back and relax and watch this wonderful, informative video on painting compositions. Today we're going to do something really, really, really exciting. I'm looking forward to this a lot. I was sitting with my students this morning on Patreon, and we were doing a Facebook Live thing with them and going over some of the paintings, and people were saying, focal point, focal point. And I was seeing paintings going, what's wrong with this composition? What's wrong with this composition? So rather than painting today, I'm going to show you how to work with focal points and eye magnets. These are things that I teach. The focal point obviously is part of my Baumann keys, you know, on painting. So the focal point's really important. Eye magnets, how you go around, is an element, and that's something that we want to discuss as part of composition. Putting together a composition is really important for a lot of people. I'm going to try to do this with some still life. If you have any questions about composition, this is the time to cover it. We are here live so that we can answer questions as we go. If you have questions about painting in general, or if you're part of the Patreon group and you're joining us now for the first time, welcome. Let us know that you are part of the Patreon group. These questions were discussed today, and I want to make sure that my Patreon students get some answers. And you get to benefit, because when they learn something, so will you. So this will be fun. Let's just discuss focal point before we go into everything. Essential for CFP, as my students call it. I mean, we use that. It's like, where's your focal point? Where's your focal point? Oftentimes when I ask students, you know, what I'm known for, if you watch my YouTube station, my thing is like, so what were you thinking? And so what I'm, you know, first thing is like, and when they come back, they go, well, this is my focal point. Or if they don't say that, then I go, where's your central focal point? And the central focal point, when you really got to try to figure out what that is, the central focal point is, what are you looking at? So right now, I want you to kind of look around your room and just gaze at things. And just look at things and look around and stuff. And as you're looking around, I want you to isolate a light switch. Okay, look at the light switch. See if you can find a light switch. Now I want you to look at the toggle on that light switch. And as you're looking at the toggle, I want you to see if you can find the screw that screws the plate onto the light switch. Can you see that? Onto the wall. Okay. Now, when I first asked you to look around the room, you didn't see anything. You were just wandering around going, why is he having me look around in the room? Because that's kind of how we think. It's like, okay, whatever. But I told you to look for a light switch, you went like, and then that all of a sudden, now, when you saw the light switch, you didn't see anything else. So the key to a focal point is this, is that it's a thing that you want the viewer to see. And it's a thing that immediately catches the viewer's eye. And we want to have your painting isolated to one central focal point that's key. We will have two separate central focal points, but the central focal point is key. And that central focal point we want to have the viewer catch. And we don't want that central focal point, if possible, to be a thing. Because we don't paint things, we paint effects, lighting on these things. So if, for instance, if we think about a stage, and that's what we're actually going to be doing today, is we're going to be looking at stages. We think about the stage, and let's just say it's Christmas time. And there you are watching this Christmas special, and it happens to be, you know, this magnificent thing with camels and horses, and there's a crèche over there, and the symphony's over there, and in the background you have the choir, OK? can visualize all that. All that's going on in stage. You know, this is pre-pandemic time, when we're just 1,000 people on stage. There's even elephants up there. It's just an amazing performance. Everything's lit beautifully. And then all of a sudden, in the background, someone's singing. And you go, oh my God, that's Barbara Streisand. And over at the stage right, there she is. And she's lit. And they got a spotlight on her. And you go, oh my God, there's Barbara Streisand. She still looks good with all that surgery. She still looks young. And so that you pay attention to that light hitting her. And as she comes across the stage, they keep that light on her. At that moment, you forget everything else. So this morning on Patreon, one of my students had this painting with several cameras all laid around, and it was just, everything was the same. And she said, I can't figure out why this painting looks the way that it does. And I told her, I said, the problem is you don't have a central focal point. You don't have a one camera that's, you know, lit up more, but you don't even have the light that's on that. And so, you know, and some of you are probably noticing the central focal point. Periodically, you'll notice that there's a little shine off my thing. That's a central focal point when that catches your eye. I wear this stuff on purpose so you can kind of look at my face. You know? So anyway, so the light on your subject matter, that's your central focal point. That is key. It's the lighting on that. So the light on Barbara Streisand diverts our attention to all that on stage, and all we do is see her. And in the background, there could be all kinds of things going on. You're not going to pay attention to her, because the stage manager wants the light on her. That's what you came to see. And that's kind of what you're going to have to do on your painting. So I'm going to demonstrate how to do some of that, and plus also I'm going to show you some handy-dandy little tools that you get to play with in that process. We're going to try to address what a central focal point is. In the process, I've got all these props down here, and I've got to give you some hints on how to set this stuff up. I highly recommend, if you're interested in becoming an artist and you want to have a style, you want to paint from life. And one of the keys that from painting from life is that we use lights and props and things. So I've got a ton of props right now. Yes?
Do you think about painting on MDF boards? MDF
board is what we use. In fact, I just got through doing a demonstration for the Patreon. It's actually like, you know, those are, what are they? Medium density fiber boards. They're like masonite boards. I recommend those. I don't recommend, it's between you and me, I don't recommend buying canvases stretch canvas until you get to very large sizes, like 24 by 36, 30 by 40, 40 by 60, because it's practical. The old masters used to paint on boards exclusively, and you get more luminous. All those pores that you have on the canvas. I mean, you're buying expensive canvases so that you can get a finish on them so you don't have all of those pores, because those pores lose the luminosity. The light goes into those pores and it doesn't reflect. And the thing is, with a painting, you want to reflect light. So the smoother the surface, and I recommend going and get MDF boards and spray them with primer. You know, if people go, oh, Stefan, you're not, you know, you need to use gesso. Well, gesso is just basically latex paint. I hate to tell you this, is that all this stuff is just kind of produced. If real gesso is made with rabbit skin glue and marble dust, and it's sanded and all this stuff, and you don't need all that anymore. All you need to do is get a surface and then coat the surface with something that seals the oil paint or acrylics from it. Now, if you're using acrylic paint, you can't obviously coat it with a oil-based product, but Rust-Oleum has some wonderful primers and sprays. I will spray a canvas half an hour before I paint on it on location, which makes it really, really handy. And my students have figured out that most of their boards, about 12 by 16, run about 98 cents if you do it right. So it's really, and it's quality. I mean, I talk about James Fetheroff and how inspired I was with his work. And he was painting on masonite. It was one of the first times I actually saw it. And I asked my teacher at the time, Rom, I said, how do you do that? How do you paint on masonite? Because I'd never seen it before. But there's certain quality when you paint on boards. And I highly recommend just making your own. You can do it so inexpensively that it's crazy. And it's as good as anything you'll buy. So quit buying expensive, smaller canvases. When you get into the bigger ones, Yes, because those boards are too heavy when they're that big to hang on a wall, and they're not impractical. Imagine an 8x10 foot painting, and you had to take it out of the house, you know, with a frame, and it was a board. It'd be really quite heavy. So,
is it a quarter inch or thick or thicker?
You can go. You can actually paint on paper if you wanted to. If you seal it, a lot of the paintings that Bierstadt and Moran painted while they were traveling was just on paper, and they put a sealer on. So you could paint on something that thin, or you could paint it thicker. It doesn't really matter. Whatever the hardware store will cut for you, that's what you want. So, okay. So let's get going. So, being an artist, you have to have a studio, and you have to be prepped in a studio. And what I find that the best thing you can have for still life painting is this is actually a sculpting stand. And what's great about this is that it's adjustable, okay? And it spins. So anything you can do is kind of mobile. So we're going to move this up so that you can kind of see what I'm doing here. And lock it. See how high that is? And you see I can move it around. So if you can't get the light to move, you can move it into the light. Ingenious, huh? It's on wheels, so yeah, I spend half my day just doing this all day. No, I don't. I have more important things to do. Okay, so that's it. Then we need something to put on here. Now, we could just put our objects on here, but, you know, and the thing is, it's kind of nice to have this black background. We could probably use that, but most studios are not built for that. Most studios don't have a nice black background, and it's kind of good to have something that you can control the light in. So, one of my students, and I don't know if she still makes it, makes these. And this is a portable box. And the reason why I like these, you don't have to have a portable one, but you know, you're not always doing still life, so every once in a while you want to just put this away. And one of my students, Anita, came and she goes, yeah, but you know, those are really quite heavy. But there's a reason why they're heavy. So first thing, we kind of fold this. It's kind of like a Chinese puzzle. And we kind of move this like this, move this like this, and this goes over here, like this, and it locks. There, okay. So as you can see, it locks. And I feel like Vanna White. So would you like a vowel or consonants. Okay, so and you can see it's again on this stand, so it's really quite flexible. I can move this, and when I get tired of this, I can take it back down again, as you saw. Fold it and put it away. Okay, so and if you've got a husband or a wife that does woodwork, you could probably make one of these, or you can just go and get something at Costco and cut out 3/4 of it. Okay, why this? Let me move it back here so we can. The reason for this is that it is a good sturdy place, and the reason why you want it heavy is because you want to first be able to take cloths, tablecloths, rugs, tapestry, and you want to be able to lay that on there. So if you had a box and you started putting some heavy drapery and stuff in, boxes have a tendency to want to fold back or lean forward. This is good and sturdy. That's why you want to kind of have it in heavier wood. And you want to kind of cover the box in something. This is just a wonderful piece of linen. Now, your composition will actually start now. So, you know, how you put this on is going to be important. So the first thing we want to talk about is like eye magnets. I'm going to scoop back so you can kind of see. So when we are setting up a composition, we could set up a composition in here. And let me lower it a little bit. See how cool that is? Okay, so when we set up a composition, this part here is the beginning stage. And when I have students start to do homework assignments with me, they forget that every part of your painting is important. And in this particular instance in the composition, we're going to talk about eye magnets, which is how the viewer finds their way around a scene. And like, you know, you can imagine this being tapestry, it can be wallpaper. One of the things I would suggest is to get really friendly with a designer, and they'll have these booklets of wallpaper patterns, different kinds of of textures of walls and stuff all in booklets, and they have to renew them every so often, and they end up with stacks and stacks and stacks of these. So those come in handy, and you can actually, if you don't want to have such a complicated scene to set up, you can actually just put a piece of wallpaper behind. So one of my students was doing a painting with a Chinese takeout, and with the Chinese takeout she got flock wallpaper, and she stuck the flock wallpaper in the back, and that ended up really nice for a scene. But in this particular instance, we want to set up the material, and this is a nice thick, you see how I'm using this, you know, that's why it's good to have the box there, so that it's handy. But what we want to do is not just put holes in there, but we want to kind of get holes that kind of create a circle. So I'm going to move this around. I'm going to see if I can kind of, okay. So you can kind of see how this goes up and down. What becomes important then is like when we set up the composition, because what you kind of have to get is that everything that I'm going to tell you is like for Western composition is from left to right.
Right.
And what the way that we actually see things is that we see things left to right in Western culture, because that's kind of how we're taught to read. And if you know anything about advertising, they get this. And really good advertisers know that the right-hand side of a newspaper is more expensive than the left-hand side. You always want to buy an ad, and here's the thing about marketing, is that I advertise in Plein Air magazine, which is a real awesome magazine. Eric Rhodes is an amazing person. He's done more for art single-handedly than any one person in the 20th century. So it's the 21st century. It's just amazing what he's done. But the Plein Air magazine, I've run ads, and you run like quarter page ads, and they're really quite expensive. And I told them, I said, I will not run an ad in a magazine unless I get the top right hand corner. Okay, and so it would be like this. I always look for the top right hand corner, and one reason is like when you open up a magazine, you usually open up backwards, and you flip this way, so you would see that would be definitely something you'd see. Plus, if somebody opens it up, they actually will end up on this side of the page before the other side. And we read from left to right. And if you're selling a product, you always want the product that you're selling on the right-hand side. Important part of composition to understand. It's not usually, it's not always, it's just understand it. Get it. Understand that that's the best. We read from left to right. And so when you're putting together a really good composition, you want to make sure that you get the feeling that the viewer comes in from the left and goes to the right. Now, we could do the same thing the other way. Actually, I should do it that way for you guys over there, but then I get confused, and I'd rather not. Okay, so so if we go from left to right into our picture, we want to make sure we have these eye magnets, these lines, taking us back in. If you notice how I've designed this, this goes up on the right and then comes back down to the left, and this is an eye magnet. This keeps your viewer in the picture. So whatever I do in here is going to keep the viewer in here. If I had lines leading out, then what happens is that the viewer comes in and then walks out the other direction, which is not good. And even like here, and sometimes you do things by accident, but I'm like looking in the camera here, but we even have some lines over here. See how that kind of brings the viewer back in? See, it's always these lines coming in that really keep the viewer interested, okay? So we're going from left to right. We have eye magnets that come in, and this could be anything, but it's kind of good to kind of break that up. Now, we're going to add objects. Now, I have a wonderful suggestion for two things. I give a lot of demonstrations and stuff, so I have gone through every thrift shop that I can possibly go, and thrift shops are great. In fact, I teach over here at Central Art, and they used to have a thrift shop, and unfortunately over the virus they moved, and I've already missed them, but I used to go in and so I bought this lovely teapot, if you can imagine. I bought this and six other items, plus a couple of sugars, on a sale of a sale of a sale. And I think I paid $2.50 for this beautiful silver teapot. See? tea. But you can buy these wonderful used items. Here's another one that I bought over there. A much more interesting shape, kind of bizarre. And we're going to be using some of these. I also have some really plain things if you don't want to go there. But whatever object we're going to do, we're going to place on the right-hand side. I'm going to shove that over there. Now, this is a small little teapot. What do people recommend about composition? Well, one thing that I recommend oftentimes when people go, I don't know how to do anything. And so one thing I recommend is doing this. And it's like, Stefan, where do you get all those props? Okay, there you go. So oftentimes you just start off with everything to begin with. So if you don't know what to paint, and oftentimes students come in and go, I don't know what to paint. I'll throw stuff at them and say, here, draw this. But anyway, sometimes the best way to do a composition, you're not quite sure, is throw everything at it. And then you take things away. Now, all of this stuff that we see here, it's all artificial. So here we have this wonderful, you know, you can buy fake pieces of bread and brie. And you can buy wonderful fake lemons that don't rot on you. You can buy wonderful, almost real like, you know, they make this stuff for restaurants for displays. You can buy pineapples and pears and grapes galore. You know, why use real grapes when you can use a real thing? You can get figs and look, garlic, beautiful. I mean, that looks real. See, with all that stuff, there's so much of this fake stuff that you can buy. You should have this, I mean, there's even a loaf of bread down here. And carrots and mushrooms. Look at this, I would love to eat those mushrooms and stuff. But everything looks so real and so appetizing and so, I mean, look at this fake apple, even with the little sticker on it. You see that? It's like, wow, you know? So, you know, go find real fake stuff. And you can do this at home yourself. So anyway, so you get all this stuff so you don't have to run to the grocery store. And then we're going to start fiddling around with the magic. So one thing what you could do here is just literally throw everything up here. Of course we're not going to have this, but we could just throw everything up on top of there. Okay, so that's kind of chaos. But you know, if you look at some of the old masters' paintings, they are chaotic. And the thing is, what you could do right now is when you're not sure about doing something original, you could just start taking things off and kind of playing with it. Because sometimes you think, oh, I want to do something with a teapot and I want a tea glass or something. But all of a sudden, these grapes look really beautiful against that. You don't know that if you don't throw it out on your thing. And the thing that you want to think about, though, is that you can turn any of this stuff into a composition with light. And so I'm going to show you that, you know, right now, this is a lousy composition. And there are students that you know, tell me, you know, when we talk about composition, you know, they have like the L and the S and the O and the W and all these different kinds of compositions. It's like, no. Just forget about that. If you control your light, you can make a composition any way that you want. I can make a composition out of really horrible paintings. And in my Patreon group, I'm actually going to be taking some of the paintings that we call dog paintings, things that are really bad paintings, and I'm going to work right on top of them and show by just putting in a central focal point, which is what we're talking about. If you put that central focal point, you can make anything work. And right now, this isn't working because there's no central focal point. And remember, the central focal point is not a thing. These are things. It's a lighting effect. It's the effect of light. It's kind of like what you're seeing on my face right now. Oops. Oh my God, I love these things. Okay, so let's turn off one of the lights and see what happens. All right, now, remember how I told you that, before I do that, I want to introduce you to this. A lot of my students think, oh, we're going to like fake it and I'm just gonna try to get a little flashlight or something. But I want you to take a look at this light, okay? This light has barn doors. Now, they don't make these lights anymore. But I highly recommend them because they are fabulous. And they get very, very hot. and they're very strong. And sometimes they're too strong for a painting, so I put them on an inline dimmer switch, which is just a dimmer switch and an extension cord. But the great thing about these is that you can shrink these down, but watch out not to touch this. This light originally cost like $300. Now they've been replaced by halogen lamps because these take up a lot of electricity. And so the halogen lamps are kind of discontinued as a whole. I think you still can get bulbs for them, but you can't get these fixtures anymore. And so the fixtures themselves are also a lot lightweight, so because they don't need to be so hot. You know, this is all solid metal. But you can buy these on eBay. And you can buy, there's sometimes they have the light with the barn doors. Now, originally the barn doors were like $80. You can buy the barn doors and the light, and sometimes you can even get the tripod for about $100. But you got to pay attention to eBay and kind of really, and now everybody's going to be looking for them. So I would be on it right now as I'm talking and try to snag one before the one or two that are on there. But they're always on there. My students find them. All right, so you want a light like this, and you want to be able to focus. Now remember, we don't paint things, we paint effects. And so what we need to do is we need to create an effect. And if you notice, I've shrunk this down very, very small, okay? That's why we have the barn doors. Now you can fake this by taking a lamp. You can use tubes. Sometimes when you have a thing, you have to have something like a tube that goes down. But be very, very careful not to burn down your house because I won't be responsible for it. So, all right. Now, the key to this too is also, yes?
What's the name of that lamp?
It's on my website, stefanbaumann.com under supplies, and you'll find it, and you can kind of search and search. And while you're there, get a free book. Everything I Know About Painting is on there. So, all right, it's getting hot just standing next to this, so let's carry on. All right, so we're going to take this light. Now, what's great about this too, notice it's on a, you know, it's on a tripod so I can move it. And this is where artists get kind of like, well, I'll just attach some light on my bookcase and then try to deal with it. It's like, it's too hard. You want to be able to move this because it's all about being watching how you do the lighting. Another secret to this is if you go and get a huge microwave box or something at Costco that's fairly large like this, and no, Costco does not sponsor me. You can take the top off and the two sections for this, but if you want to actually use it for a light source, you wouldn't do that. You'd leave it all kind of solid except for the front. And in the hole over here, on the side over here, you make a hole. And you can shine a light through the hole like this, and that the light will go through a hole and you'll get that little spotlight, that Barbra Streisand effect over there. There's so much stuff going through my head. It's like, this is my favorite part. Now we're going to work on getting the central focal point. So the central focal point is the effect of light. Now remember, we're coming in from the left-hand side to the right-hand side, and we want our central focal point to be somewhere in the middle and on the right. Now I'm not quite sure how that's going to actually look in here. Oh, that might be too dark. David LaFell, eat your heart out. All right. Can you actually see that? So we can actually shine this and we get it closer. Now sometimes you've got to get your light just outside of your realm. So we're going to go this. Now remember, this is left to right. So the light's on the left-hand side, the central focal point's on the right. If we come into a painting from the left-hand side, we want our central focal point to be on the right. And what we want to do, even with that chaos that I threw out there, by putting the central focal point in this area, and I can work it and move it closer, and move this closer, and lower my light just enough, I can get that to focus practically anywhere I want. Okay. So you can move it around. You could say, oh, you know, I want it a little bit further back. I want to have more, you know, like, oh, Stefan, all of your paintings are so dark. You know, you can actually like get something like that, you know. So you can actually use the lighting to get a central focal point. If you have a central focal point, you're going to have success with your painting. And notice the teapot is also provided left to right, you know, there's an eye magnet right here coming down here. And the thing is, now what you sit there and go, you know, I want to see more of the teapot. And so you could start taking some of this crap off of here. Okay. And you start moving things around. Now, one of the things that I recommend when you're painting, you got to be kind of sensitive to, is that you got to kind of remember the rule like big, smaller, smaller. If you're going to do something kind of simple, notice that the teapot, this is a small teapot, but it's definitely in the composition, it's larger. Okay, so I'm going to pull all this stuff off here. One of the things when you're putting together a composition is that it's so romantic. Dark lights, little wine, ready for a nice little evening. So we have, this is a small teapot, but that's okay. So we have a large shape, and this is where a lot of artists kind of mess up, is that they'll have a large shape and then they'll have two shapes like this. Let's just open this up, okay? So one of my students on Patreon did this morning, is that, you know, so they had this, and they had something like this, okay? And the problem is that compositionally it's kind of boring to look at because you have these two items kind of look like like breast practically. They're just kind of round objects that are exactly the same. And not really pleasing when you look at that. And you kind of always have to watch out too that you don't do things in fours. So here we actually have 1, 2, 3, 4 items. So we want to kind of watch out we don't do that. But you want to have something large, something medium, and you want something small. So we have one big object here, which is going to be in, you know, my central focal point, and I want to try to focus in on that. Now you want the central focal point to be central. When I ask students, so where's your central focal point? And I go, yeah, that's a central focal point, that's a central focal point. There are about 5 different elements in a central focal point. One, it's the brightest light. Okay, so that's the central focal point because we don't paint things, we paint effects. Number 2 is the biggest contrast. So you'll have the brightest light next to the darkest dark somehow. So you kind of arrange your subject so that you have the brightest brights and the darkest darks next to each other. That's another element that you have to understand. Number 3, it's the area that you have the most detail, the hardest lines. Now, artists always want to try to paint something that's very painterly and loose, and you get that by keeping the central focal point hard-edged and everything else kind of let it fall apart. And when you're painting something this and you're initially painting it, you want to kind of concentrate on the effect of light first and then base everything else outside of that. Then notice we have a shape here that's the largest size in the middle area of the painting, going to have the biggest contrast there. Hardest edges, biggest contrast, and sometimes even if you notice, look at how cool, I don't know if you guys can see it, but even this is shiny, it got a beautiful reflection on the teapot there. That's also an interesting element to have as a central focal point. Now notice the color. Now a lot of students will say, oh, my central focal point won't be where these bright colors are, but really color is when you squint your eyes, color just goes away because of the value of it. So we have a big shape, a smaller shape, and then we want to introduce something that's smaller. So we have like big, smaller, small, okay? Not big, big, and alike. Okay, they even have the strings on the, it's so cool, okay. So this wouldn't work, but this would, see? And you want to kind of always make sure that the objects kind of lay over each other, okay? And then you can kind of move it. You can see when you start moving the light around, you can see that you start getting cast shadows, which would be kind of interesting to actually nail. So the central focal point would be the brightest light, and you keep moving this around. Now, the great thing about having something like this is that you can move it around and say, you know what, I don't want to have the light on the teapot. I want to have the light on the cherries down there. Okay, so now the teapot's kind of in the background. Notice all of the background light color, the background here. It's kind of a beautiful luminous color. You can see how it's lit up. It's not dark. It actually is light. And you can see that there's still the folds and stuff, even if things are in shadow. And you could still have these things in the background, which might kind of add a little bit of extra depth to it. But as long as they're in the shadow, the effect of light is always kind of key that you want to get. So we'll move this around until we finally get that. We can add, maybe you sit and go, well, I'm going to add one more thing. And like I said, I kind of like the lemon that just rolled there. You see, like having all this stuff handy, how all of a sudden you could start using some of this stuff? We can even throw in an asparagus like that. See, that's an eye magnet that takes us to the vase there. There's pineapples and orange slices. I don't know, but let's kind of keep it simple. So now we have a central focal point, and let me see where that would be. Okay, so I'm going to put the central focal point there. Now I'm not choosing that there on the persimmon here. I'm not choosing that. Unfold these. But I'm not choosing that because it's orange. I'm choosing it because it's the strongest effect of light. And one of the things that you need to get, and we've talked about this as a new key, and that is angles. Now, I want you to pay attention to this, is that, okay, so the central focal point, this needs to be the brightest, lightest area in the painting, and that would be right here. And the reason why we would choose that is I want you to notice that the angle of the persimmon here is the same angle. It's perpendicular to the light. Okay, so you see the light coming down? There's only one thing that's really like that angle that reflects that. Now I can move this around all over my silver vase, and there isn't anything in there that has that angle. So you've got to make sure that if you're going to have a central focal point, it's got to be perpendicular to the angle of the light. And that's why this works really well in there. And the thing is, you could put the oddest things into a composition. It doesn't really matter. And then we could take things out. But in a good composition, you have one key central focal point, and that's there. Then you need to find two more central focal points. And the other two central focal points are to aid you with using the eye magnet. So we're using the big eye magnet around the vase here. Around the coffee pot, we're using the eye magnet of all this in here. And what we want to do is wherever you decide that you want to make your painting, you have your key focal point, which is here, and then you need to find two more central focal points. Now, these two central focal points are because we don't stare at things. So if I told you to stare at that light switch, which I told you to do at the beginning, if you just came in when you were staring at a light switch, your husband would come in and go, "What's wrong with you?" So, you know, we always kind of like look at, if you're having a conversation with somebody and you stare at their nose or their teeth, they'll start picking their teeth because we don't look that way. That's not normal. So when we look at a central focal point, we'll look at it and then we'll dart away. And then we come back and look at it. And so if I'm having a conversation with Anita, my eyes will lock with Anita. And a central focal point, when we're talking about humans, it's always the eyes first, even more so than the light. And if you want to try to create a lighting effect with a central focal point with humans, and you don't want them to look at their eyes, you have to kind of really try to disguise the eyes, usually behind hats and stuff, so that you don't focus in on that. But we're wired this way. But you have a central focal point that's on the persimmon, it's bright and light, has the angle. But then we need to find two more central focal points so we could glance off. So if I'm looking at Anita, I'm having a conversation with her, my eyes will go drift to the right or to the left. And oftentimes something else will happen. And so I'll go to the right and I'll see this, you know, this beautiful Rolls Royce coming up the road. And I go, wow, that's a nice Rolls Royce. And I still end up talking to Anita. And then all of a sudden I see some gal over there watering her yard. I go to the left and go to the right. And usually it's kind of within eye shot. And then, you know, if all of a sudden that Rolls Royce dries up and a gang of kids jump out and start killing the person that's watering their lawn over there, all of a sudden I'm going to stop looking at Anita. I'm going to be looking at the action that's happening over there. So the thing is, your central focal point here is, this is Anita here. The other two central focal points have to be eye-catching and something that you'd actually see, but you don't hang on. And so you won't have the hard edges, you won't quite have the lighting effect, and sometimes they're kind of hard to find, but you know, right here where I see a setup, there's really some strong light over here, which, you know, kind of gets me into the background, which kind of pulls me alongside the back of the teapot. Are we actually in frame there, Anita? Can you actually see the back handle of the teapot? Okay. So the back handle of the teapot, which brings me forward. And then if you can also see here, remember that lemon that just fell into the painting here? That might be a central focal point. So as I'm looking at this, I might glance at this, I might glance at that. And then you would make sure you'd have your folds fold around here. And so the eye catches over here. Hopefully you have a fold in your material that brings you up. These lines bring you back down, and you start making your central composition all in the middle here. So it's just an interesting way of working, and it doesn't really matter what you end up throwing in here. As long as you have your central focal point in there, you can kind of add all kinds of stuff to it, and it still holds. Now, yeah. Notice, too, is that the light is coming in at this direction, and it's all about the lighting. So we've got all this light happening in here. And the light's coming from the left to the right. And our main subject is over on the right. But we could actually go backwards. Here we go. So we could have the light coming the other way. Now. But we could actually do the same thing. You know, we could have the light coming from the other direction. It's not quite as powerful, but it is kind of interesting. If you'd want to have the light coming from the opposite direction, you always want to have your central focal point opposite the light source. So if we were going to do something like this, we would have the light coming in from now, which would be from the right to the left. If you're looking at this, you would have the light coming from the right, and you want your central focal point to be on the left. And the reason why you want to have that is you want to have the longest trail of light, because what happens is that if we put the light over here, if the object's over here and the light's coming this way, what are you going to do with the rest of your painting over here? You know, it's all jammed over there. So there's a center point here that you always want to cross over. So if the light's coming from the right, you want your central focal point to be on the left side of center. If you do the opposite way, I've never done this way. If your light's coming this way, you want to have the objects be on this side of the composition. So having the placement of things to the effect of light, you always want to have the light going across your subject. So that's that. Let's just play around because I have all this cool stuff. This thing I love. I'm going to leave all this other stuff here. This thing, this is, again, a shape that I got at the thrift shop. Isn't that beautiful? Some kind of Indian thing. The great thing about thrift shops is that, you know, it's kind of like when people get wedding gifts and stuff, they always have these magnificent gifts, but they don't know what to do with them, so they hang on to them for a while and then they give them away. But you can kind of see how important it is to have props and to have lighting and all this set up, so. But this thing's always fun to kind of hang grapes around. Kind of has kind of a Greekish kind of, look at that. Wouldn't you like that to go paint? This is freeze frame it for a second, you can kind of paint it. Now I suggest if you go to freeze frame it, go on to YouTube and get it next week, so that you can actually see see it in the way I see it. But here again, too, I'm having the objects create an eye magnet. So if you notice compositionally, I've got the grapes going around, up, drooping down. Ideally, sometimes these things have wires in them, so you could place them in places that you can. You can't do this with real stuff. And if it's real stuff, you can't leave it there very long because it starts attracting flies. Now the old masters used to do that. They would set up a still life and they'd work a month on it. And they'd have these beautiful, beautiful flowers and roses. And you know, what would happen is that they would paint the roses as they were, and because they didn't have photography to make it still. And so they'd paint the roses as they were that day. And then they would go to the studio and some of the petals would fall. They would paint those roses like that. And then they would paint the roses as they died. So over a month, they would have bugs and you'd see these beautiful still lifes with bugs and dead flowers and live flowers and all this stuff. And so it was almost like a transition of life to death as the still life would sit there. But with these plastic artificial grapes, I mean, I think you're crazy to work from real life. You just kind of start collecting this. I got a whole box of them. Yeah, and you have them at a moment's notice. I mean, how often have you wanted to get a beautiful lemon? And then you can't find a beautiful lemon like this if you try. Look at that. It's like the quintessential lemon. So, and then also one thing you kind of want to do is not only do you have eye magnets that go this way in a painting, but it's kind of good to have eye magnets that lead you to the back. So I wanted to look at these grapes. Notice how I arrange these grapes. Notice I'm going not only up and around, but also the way that they're laying, they're taking us into the back there, which is kind of interesting to kind of look at for a composition. So getting compositions that go around, like here we got the composition going around. Let's turn on this light because we're talking about stuff. The thing is, everybody always says, oh, you just always paint dark back. You know, it's like, yeah. So you can have any kind of color background or, like I said, wallpaper. This light you can handle. Feel how bright it is. You can get that on the inline thing. Let's see if I can kind of tone that down. Maybe what I'll do is I'll turn on the light real quick so we can kind of see. Look at Caravaggio. Love Caravaggio, but he did a lot of this stuff too. All right, so this might be not so blown out now. We can talk about it. I mean, just look at that. Isn't that an amazing composition? But see, here what I was trying to get to is this line here. And I don't know if I could drop this. You could see. See, this is the great thing about this. I don't know if it's going to make it any better. Or you might be able to look down on it a little bit more. But what we have here is that we have, can you see? It's still in the picture frame. Yeah. So what we have here is, notice the grapes not only go around like we did originally, but they go back. And these asparagus are bringing us forward. And so we're creating a circle that goes in the back and the front. And this is really great here, just by placing this in the background. This now becomes more 3D. You have actually kind of an open front, the viewer. And you can always drop. And people kind of forget this part of the painting here, but this part here could actually be something that drops off to the edge of the surface, brings the viewer up, we go up here, the eye magnets go down, bring this down. So eye magnets are really a crucial part of your painting. Now with this composition, you know, again, you want to have the light coming from left to right if you can possibly do it, but you know, you would focus in. And the only thing that we can see on this vase that is perpendicular, that the angle is like over there, we have that angle there, we have those angles on the grapes, you know, some of the cherries, depending on. And so, you know, when you're actually like sitting here scouting for something, you kind of really have to like find the angle of something in order to actually make that work. So there's a lot of information in putting together a composition. But those are the key elements, the central focal point, which is key. Without that central focal point, and remember, your central focal point can't be a thing. Even though that's beautiful, it's a beautiful shape, it can't be a thing. It's the light on it. Okay, so it's how the light falls on it. And if you notice right now, boom, there's the central focal point. That's really pretty. But we could have the lemons, wherever we face that. Now, wherever we decide we're going to have that, we can even have it up there, but you want one key about the central focal point that I forgot to tell you, and it's in its name, central focal point. It has to be like in the middle third. So that would be, you know, up here might be a little bit too high for the middle third, so you want to kind of concentrate it down a bit. So you want to have a central focal point. That central focal point is the brightest, lightest thing in the painting, not the thing itself. It has the largest contrast between lights and shadows. It can't be a color by itself. Color, if you squint your eyes, just disappears into a value. You want to have eye magnets that lead to the central focal point. It's the area that you have most of the detail and stuff. So anyway, that's just about what we can cover. Our time is over, and hopefully you can meet us on Patreon. Like I said, I have some exciting news about Patreon, which is going to benefit everybody on the platform, plus you if you haven't seen it. I'm doing all kinds of paintings that are just for that. YouTube, of course, I've got my PBS television show. Be sure to look at some of my PBS television shows that are listed on YouTube, the national parks, because they're amazing videos of me painting outdoors. And there's some videos of me painting outdoors already, but we will be doing more of that outdoors maybe next week. I'm not quite sure. Go to my website at www.stefanbaumann.com, and there you can actually download a free book. So you want to take advantage of that. I have a workshop in the spring and fall, one in October. There's still a couple of places left. Please feel free to contact me for that. And without further ado, thank you so much. I hope to see you out there painting on location. And always remember, don't go into your studio unless you're going to change the world. And always remember to paint with passion. I'm Stefan Baumann, and thanks for tuning in.